Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is one of the speakers at this year's Catholic Answers Conference, Restoring Marriage Today. Her talk was entitled, Keeping the Family Together, Public Policies and Personal Strategies.
We're going to hear from a very knowledgeable, locked-in leader and defender of marriage and its restoration. We're still a little bit bitter that she relocated to Lake Charles, Louisiana, but at the end of your rows, there are golden sheets that you can just pass along the end of the row. The Ruth Institute information sheets, and I'm sure Dr. Roback Morris will tell you more. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris founded the Ruth Institute in 2008 as a vehicle, among other things, to help university students and leaders there understand why a free society depends upon continuity with a strong institution of marriage as it has been for millennia. She's the author of many books and peer-reviewed articles. She earned her PhD in economics at the University of Rochester and has taught economics at Yale University and George Mason University. She's been diagnosing the roots of our contemporary sexuality crisis before diagnosing the roots of our contemporary sexuality crisis was cool. Please give a warm Catholic Answers Live welcome to Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris.
Thank you, Patrick. Thanks, Patrick. Wait a minute, somebody fooled with my slides. What's going on here? Somebody put their stuff down, messed with my slides. Anyway, hi everybody. I am so glad to be back here in San Diego. I do miss all of my friends here in San Diego, so it's really great to be back and see so many of you and to see that you've brought your friends with you. So it's quite wonderful to be here. We are doing well in Lake Charles, Louisiana. In Lake Charles, people think it's a traffic jam if they have to wait for the traffic light for two turns of the light. You know, we think it's bad. That's terrible traffic, you know. And my son has a job on the other side of town. It takes us 10 minutes to get him there. You know, so that's our idea of, you know, it's kind of nice. It's charming after all this. But anyway, my topic today is keeping the family together, public policies and personal strategies. And I want to begin by telling you that the Ruth Institute has a dream. The Ruth Institute's dream is that every child be welcomed into a loving home with a married mother and father, so that every child can have a relationship with his or her own parents unless some unavoidable tragedy takes place to prevent it, so that every adult without exception can know his or her cultural heritage and genetic identity. And when these rights are violated, we call this a structural injustice to the child. And I want you to underline that concept, a structural injustice to the child. I'm through arguing for marriage in terms of adults. If you really want to defend marriage, we've got to start talking about children. And so this concept of the structural justice to children is absolutely crucial to everything that we do at the Ruth Institute. Now, we also have developed a goal. And the goal of the Ruth Institute is to create a lasting and Christ-like social movement to end the agony and the injustice of family breakdown. Let me say that again. A lasting and Christ-like social movement to end the agony and the injustice of family breakdown. Because I think you'll agree, it is agonizing and there are many, many injustices. And so the first part of my talk is going to talk about that dream and we'll be focused on public policies. Second part of the talk, we'll be talking about this goal of creating a social movement and we'll be talking about the personal strategy. So that's how this 45-minute talk all holds together. So let's begin with the Ruth Dream, public policies. I like to call this part of the program the sexual revolution and its victims. The sexual revolution and its victims is the title of my latest book, and as you can see, we have an image of Marilyn Monroe on the cover of this book. Now, we think Marilyn Monroe is a great icon or symbol of both halves of the statement. She's a great symbol of the sexual revolution, isn't she? She's glamorous, she's beautiful, it's exciting. She's been dead a long time, but people still carry tote bags and t-shirts and that with her picture on it. And what are they trying to say? They're trying to participate in her celebrity and her glamour, her beauty and excitement. That's what it's all about. But at the same time, she had a very, very sad life. According to her biographer, she had 12 abortions before the age of 29, if you can imagine such a thing. She died at the age of 39 from a drug overdose. We still don't know whether it was suicide or murder or an accident. We still don't know. But that part is all airbrushed away. When the kids put her on the t-shirt, they're not thinking about dying at 39, you know. So we think she's a great symbol of the sexual revolution and its victims because she, in fact, was victimized, in a sense, by the sexual revolution. So I want to begin by talking with you about the sexual revolution. The sexual revolution promised equality, freedom, and fun, but it is proven to be inhuman. And so allow me to illustrate the human train wreck with the story of a little girl that I will call Elise. Now, Elise is 6 years old, and she lives with her grandmother. Elise's mother never married, but she has two children with two different men, and Elise is the elder child. Elise and her family are an example of what our elite class is pleased to call an alternative family form. You've heard this phraseology. And what they mean to say when they use this term is that having children outside of a lifelong marriage between one man and one woman is not particularly a big deal. It's not a big deal for the people who do it, for the children, and not for society as a whole. Just another lifestyle that we ought to support, celebrate, and never, never judge. Now, demographers describe Elise's family with a new term called multi-partner fertility. They came up with this term, multi-partner fertility, because they came to realize that when a woman has a child out of wedlock, the odds are very high that her second child will also be out of wedlock and with a different guy. And so what they figured out is that children in that situation of multi-partner fertility are at additional risk for all sorts of bad outcomes. Now, they'll tell you that children like Elise are at risk. And by these standards, this particular little girl whom I know, Elise, she's in pretty good shape because she lives with her grandmother who loves her. She's not in foster care. She's never been abused by her mother's boyfriends, to the best of my knowledge. And she's doing okay in school. But let me tell you just one fact about Elise. When her family gets together every year for Christmas and Thanksgiving, and her mother comes over to grandma's house, her mother comes with her new boyfriend and the new baby that they had together. After every one of these family get-togethers, Elise acts out with angry and unmanageable behavior. For about a week afterwards, she wets her bed every night. Those family gatherings are a reminder that her mother doesn't want her. Every holiday stirs up the feeling that her mother doesn't love her. If she were old enough to put it into words, she might tell you that she feels like a leftover from a previous relationship. This is what an alternative lifestyle looks like to a child. So we're faced with two competing worldviews. The worldview of people of faith is this. Every child, and hence every adult, has identity rights and relational rights with respect to their parents. And adults have obligations to provide these things for children. Now, we don't normally like to say that too loud because people in our time resist knowing that they have any kind of obligations, right? So we don't usually blurt that out. However, the competing worldview, every adult has the right to the sexual activity they want with a minimum of inconvenience. And children just have to accept whatever the adults give them. We don't normally say that too loud because we'd be ashamed of ourselves if we just blurted it out like that. But this is approximately the position of most of the people in power in most of the so-called developed countries around the world. They believe that it is the job of the government to minimize the inconvenience that adults experience from their sex lives. Now, we at the Ruth Institute have created a brochure called Do You Know a Survivor of the Sexual Revolution? It is in your welcome bags, okay, those little blue tote bags. Please pull it out right now. Please take a moment now to pull it out. It's the only thing that doesn't say Catholic Answers all over it, so you'll know that that's the one. It's kind of blended in there, okay? But in a few minutes, I'm going to talk about this brochure, so let's take a moment about it to look for it now. So let me take a few moments while you're doing that to define for you the sexual revolution. And by the way, if you sign up on these goldenrod sheets, what you're signing up for, just so you're clear, is you're signing up for, no salesman will call. What you're signing up for is our weekly electronic newsletter, which I know some of you already get because some of you have been on our list for a long time. But you will also receive a PowerPoint version, a PDF version of these PowerPoint slides. So you don't have to scribble down every word that I'm saying right now. You will get these slides later, so be sure that you sign those up. Okay, so let me take a moment to define for you the sexual revolution. A good and decent society, I think it has three basic tenets, okay? The first revolutionary idea is that a good and decent society ought to separate sex from childbearing. And the second idea is that a good and decent society ought to separate both sex and childbearing from marriage. Okay, so do you recognize this as being part of our culture? That you're entitled to sex without babies, you're entitled to sex without marriage, you're entitled to marriage without babies, you're entitled to sex without babies, babies without sex. Oh yeah, that last part. We're now at that point where you're allowed to have sex without babies. Now see, at the beginning, we all thought it was going to be a lot of fun to have sex without babies. Some of you are old enough to remember that. Woodstock and all that. Come on, don't be ashamed. I was there too. Look, we all thought it was going to be a lot of fun to have sex without babies. Now we're at the point where we're having babies without having sex, which I'm pretty sure is not as much fun as the old-fashioned way. I'm just saying, okay? So these are the ideas that have created the hookup culture, the divorce culture, the single mother by choice culture, and the adultery culture that has led to millions of users on the Ashley Madison Internet Adultery Matching Service. Isn't that charming? The final idea of the sexual revolution is that men and women are completely interchangeable. Any differences that we observe between men and women are socially constructed and almost certainly unjust. A good and decent society should obliterate all differences between men and women, except for those that are deliberately chosen by the individuals. A man can become a woman can become a man. Society's job is to endorse the individual's self-understanding and enforce it throughout the rest of society. Now, there's just one obvious problem with this set of ideological claims. All three of them are false. Sex actually does make babies. Do you all know that? Okay, that's good. I'm glad. I always do a little check there. One time I was giving a speech at a university in Arizona that I won't name, and I said this, sex makes babies, and the law professor argued with me. She said, no, it doesn't. I said, oh, what do you mean? And she said, unprotected sex makes babies. Okay? So what in their minds, sex doesn't make babies. Babies are caused by the desire of the parents or by contraceptive failure. The problem is these little contraceptive failures sometimes appear without our desires. We hear a few of them in the back of the room, right? You know, that's where babies actually come from. Children actually do need their own parents, and marriage attaches children to their parents. That's why we need marriage. And finally, men and women actually are different. And so here is our situation, my friends. We are living in a situation where the people in power in all the major developed countries, the richest people that world history has ever known, are committed to this set of ideological claims. They believe that they have a moral obligation to build a society around three claims that are patently false. That's what we're dealing with. And it takes a lot of force to accomplish something that is that untrue. And it takes a lot of propaganda to make people believe that this stuff is true. So if you ever feel like you're being weighed down and oppressed by all the stuff that's coming at you, there's one more TV show celebrating this or that, one more bogus study claiming this or that that you can't possibly believe. If you feel like the headlines and the media is completely against you, let me tell you something. You are correct. This is what we're dealing with. The communists thought it was possible to build a prosperous society without any property rights. That was not possible. They had to work really hard to get that done, and in the end it didn't work. And that's where we are here. That is why I say that the sexual revolution is beyond left and right. This is not a left and right thing. It is an ideal, it's its own ideology, standing on its own, beyond left and right, trying to do the impossible, trying to create a fantasy ideology. Okay? And that is why it has become and had to become a totalitarian movement. You must see it for what it is. It is a totalitarian movement that no Christian should have anything to do with. We should not compromise with it. We should not give it any quarter. And our mistake has been that we have not fully understood the seriousness of what we've been dealing with. So now let's take a look at our brochure together, okay? It's called, Do You Know a Survivor of the Sexual Revolution? Now, as you open up the flap and you look down this left-hand column, I just want you to open the first page here. Look down this left-hand column and you'll see the list of people who've been harmed by the sexual revolution. At the top of the list, children of divorce. You see that? And as you look down the column, I expect you'll see somebody that you know, okay? Men, women, and children, everybody's been harmed in some way or another, with the possible exception of a handful of predatory alpha males. But pretty much everybody else has been harmed. We've got the reluctantly divorced person who would like to have stayed married, but the law takes sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. Back in the last talk, Jimmy Akin was talking to you about the biblical understanding of marriage and divorce. Do you realize that our law takes side with the adulterous party? That's what no fault does. No fault removes adultery from the list of marital faults, and therefore, porneia, forget it. It's the pornographer, it's the porneia, it's the person committing adultery who is favored by the law. That is a big problem. That's a big problem. Now, as you open up the brochure, you'll see on this column over here the lies that people were told. Each and every one of these groups of people, we've got 12 survivor types of the sexual revolution, and every one of these survivor types has three or four lies that they were told, that they're acting on, that they're doing these things based on a set of beliefs that are untrue. And right at the top of the list, the very first one, kids are resilient. That's the granddaddy of all lies of the sexual revolution. Kids are resilient. We little precious snowflake adults, you know, we're going to melt at the first sign of trouble. But the kids are tough, you know, they're going to take it. They'll be just fine. Many people broke up perfectly adequate marriages and embarked on new relationships with these ideas in their mind. And if they had known how much their children would suffer, I feel sure some of them would have chosen something else. Now, on the slide right now, I'm showing you some of the risks facing children of divorce. This table is based on literally hundreds of studies that have been performed over the last 40 years, and it's at the center of another brochure that we have over at our table over there called Children in Divorce, which you can look at and purchase some later if you want to. But this table is based on literally hundreds of scholarly books and articles that have been produced. And these negative outcomes, in my opinion, derive from the basic injustice done to children by separating them from one of their parents without an unavoidable reason. And here's why I think that is true. Secure attachments between a child and each of his or her parents builds the foundation for the development of the child's personality. In the child's little world, mother and father are the most powerful and important people in their world. Parents act as stand-ins for God himself. And from this most basic relationship, the child develops his sense of self as a social and spiritual being. Is the world a safe place for me? Do I really belong here? Am I worthy of love? Now, divorcing parents may say to their children, we still love you, we just don't love each other anymore. But the child's other parent is half of who the child is. The ch- child can't make sense of these contradictory claims because they're not really true. The parent creating the separation is telling the child, I want something else more than I want a relationship with your other parent, that is, with half of you. And in their hearts, the kids know it. And that's why I believe they're so upset. That's where all the anxiety comes from. It's no wonder they're not doing well in school and all these other kinds of things. So as I mentioned, this table is based on another brochure that the Ruth Institute has produced called Children and Divorce. Children of divorce were more or less the first victims of the sexual revolution. They're followed by children of single parents and now by children of same-sex couples. We intend to create brochures for all 12 of the victims of the sexual revolution, and you can see the ones we've already created back at the Ruth table. Now, all of these kids have at least one thing in common. The adult's relationship with their sex partner is more important to them than their relationship with the child's other parent. Needless to say, that conflict doesn't even arise in a family where the husband and wife, the mother and father, are continuously married to each other. That issue doesn't even come up. Do I love you more than I love my current sex interest, right? It doesn't even come up if mom and dad get married and stay married. So it's no wonder that the kids are having so many troubles. I want to mention one last category of victims of the sexual revolution. You like my slide there with the little baby barcode? Okay. These are donor-conceived persons that I want to talk to you about. Advocates for donor conception try to create the impression that donor-conceived persons are so wanted by their parents that the chosenness of their children will override all other considerations. The problems that so often arise from living with an unrelated adult, the pain children so often feel from the absence of one of their biological parents, their longing for that biological parent, all of these things can be safely disregarded. But the children of donor conception have their own perspective. Many of them do long for their missing parent. Some do feel shame about being partially purchased. Some have anxieties about inadvertently encountering an unknown half-sibling. I recently met a young man who has reason to believe that he has 500 half-siblings. His sperm donor father was a medical student and donated sperm every month for 10 years. And he had too many experiences in his hometown of meeting people who looked strangely like himself. He finally moved away, moved about 2,000 miles away from his hometown because he couldn't take it anymore. Obviously, this is not a problem that most of our kids face, and it's a problem, I would argue, that no child should have to face. This is an injustice to the child to put them through that. So third-party reproduction arrangements are morally problematic for all the same reasons as divorce, only more intensely. Most of these children have a donor gamete who is anonymous and is not part of the family. One of the parents has made a decision to completely cut the other parent out of their lives. So this is a greater injustice than a divorce or separation because it's deliberate, it's from the beginning, and it's permanent. So how many victims of the sexual revolution are there really? Well, we don't really know for sure, but we do know a few things about it. We know that about 1 million children per year have experienced the divorce of their parents, each and every year since 1972. We do know that over 1 million children have been born to unmarried parents every year since 1988. In 2008, 1.7 million children were born to unmarried parents. By 2010, there were about 20 million children living in single-parent households. I want you to know that I will never accept this as normal. I don't care how often it happens, I don't care how common it becomes, and I certainly don't care what the Supreme Court has to say about it. I will never accept this as normal. Thank you. Now, I laid out some of these basic concepts in my first book, Love and Economics, back in 2001. The subtitle of this book is, It Takes a Family to Raise a Village. Do y'all remember what that's a... Yeah, Mrs. Clinton, you know, who's kind of back in the news these days, it was never clear what it was the village was supposed to be doing. Her book just said, it takes a village To do what? I mean, it wasn't even clear, you know, what she was talking about, except we all pretty much knew she was talking about federal programs, and we're just not really talking about moms and dads and new babies and stuff. Anyway, so we're thinking about bringing this book out again this summer, a special edition, with a new cover. I don't know what you think about this cover. What do you think? Now, you know, we tried to do this in 2008. We tried to come out with this book, and we found that none of our people wanted to buy this book. They all, you know, kind of laughed at the cover concept and everything. But we figured out that our people, you know, people who would like our message and stuff, just didn't want a picture of Hillary Clinton in their house, even with tape over her mouth, you know. So if you guys are interested in this, you know, give us a little buzz over there at the book table and let us know. And then if there's interest, we'll try to bring it out. But, you know, otherwise it's like, you know, who wants to have to shred a whole box of pictures with Hillary Clinton on the cover? Well, I don't know. Maybe I shouldn't say that. Anyway, okay, so now we're at the second part of our talk here, which is personal strategies and the Ruth Institute goal to create a lasting and Christ-like social movement that will end the agony and the injustice of family breakdown. Now, we want a lasting solution. We want a Christ-like solution. We don't want it. If it's not Christ-like, I'm not interested in it, right? You're not interested in it either. So we want a Christ-like solution. And if it's not Christ-like, it's not going to last anyway, right? And so a lot of the things, I just want to point out, that a lot of the things that we do in this culture that we've been trying to do actually are kind of superficial, all right? So if you have a media campaign to talk everybody into being nicer to their kids or whatever, that doesn't get to the core difficulty that we have here. These are serious, deep structural problems we're talking about here with all of these lies here in the sexual revolution. It's a lot. So the media strategies are not really, you know, going to cut it, right? It's just kind of superficial. I'm not saying you should stop doing it, but I just need to say we have to do something a little more. Same with political types of solutions. Politics is important. I don't want to say don't be involved in politics, but a lot of times people have the feeling that they're being manipulated, right? People are promising you stuff and saying stuff and you don't really believe them, and so on and so forth, okay? So we need a Christ-like lasting solution. It needs to be a little bit more substantial than what we have right here. Now, what image do you think I'm going to put up there next? A brick house. Okay, yes, you're right. There's a brick house. But, actually, that is something substantial. Now, look at that. That's St. Peter's. Now, there are only 10 million photographs of St. Peter's on the internet, right? I picked this one because this is my daughter's field trip to Rome in 2008 from St. Joseph's Academy. Do we have some St. Joseph's Academy people here? All right, right on. St. Joseph's people. Okay, we all have these photos, and we love it. But look at that, there is a church. If you're worshiping in a little 1970s big box kind of thing, I'm sorry. If you're a Protestant and you go to a lecture hall with a pipe organ in it, you know, I'm sorry, that's a church. That thing's built to last, okay? And that's what we're looking for. We're looking for something more substantial. And so we can, there are two ways that people can contribute and participate. And we're now talking about the personal strategies, all right? So the first way that people can participate and be involved is that we know that it's time to do something about all of those victims. And the first way that you can be involved is that the victims of the sexual revolution need not remain victims. We want them to move from being victims to being survivors. And here's how you can help. If you have a past and possibly a guilty conscience, if many people out there have a past and a guilty conscience, but they don't have to be our enemies, right? A lot of them are, because we, you know, a man in a Roman collar walks into the room and they all feel guilty, right? He's like an affront to them, right? But they don't need to be our enemies. They need to be moved along so that they can connect the dots between what happened to them and what they're experiencing and this ideology, this toxic ideology that we're all dealing with. So if you have a past and a guilty conscience, you can speak about the pain of the sexual revolution from your own experience. Mary Magdalene can speak a truth that the Virgin Mary doesn't even know. Okay? And so you can spread the word that it's okay to talk about the harms of the sexual revolution. If you're a survivor, don't be afraid to speak out. Those of us who are baby boomers who participated in the sexual revolution and lived to tell about it, we need to tell about it, okay? Because we need to make a second career out of speaking the truth about our experiences. And if you're embarrassed to admit it, consider this. Every time you're embarrassed and say nothing, you're leaving that blank out there. And when you speak, and you can be discreet, you don't have to be like you're on Oprah or Geraldo or something, I'm not talking about that. But if you speak candidly with people that you love, you're making it easier for the next person to confess and to say that this was wrong. And you may save a young person from doing something really stupid. Okay? So just put that in your heart, and I am counting on you. I feel quite certain that you have enough good sense to know how to handle this. Okay? Now, a lot of times, you know, I give these speeches and they're full of facts and figures and data, and people will say to me, Dr. Morse, what do I say when this comes up? Dr. Morse, I can't remember all those facts and figures you put out. I can't remember what Jimmy Akin said. How do I say it? What do I say? Listen, I don't want you to say it like I would say it. You need to say it the way you would say it, from your heart. And that brings me to the next way in which you can help, which is you can be involved in healing friendship. All right? Now, at this time, I want you to put in your mind, you've been looking at this brochure, I've been provoking you quite a bit with sad stories. What I want you to do is think of one person who's been harmed by the sexual revolution. And go ahead and write it down on your notepad or in the back of your program, there's a place for notes. Write down that one person's name, and I want you to stay focused on that one person. If 10 or 15 other people come to your mind, write their names down too and just let them sit there. But have one person in your mind and heart. I'm not going to tell you what to say, at least not yet, okay? But we're going to go through a little exercise of what you're going to do with that person. And this is a picture, by the way, of guys doing stuff, right? They're being friends. They're not evangelizing, at least not directly. They're indirectly evangelizing, okay? So I think everybody here can do this. This is a picture of two women gardening. Now, I picked this picture particularly because I have a friend who is an allied attorney for the Alliance Defending Freedom, which means that she defends people for religious liberty problems when they come up in her community, okay? And she used to be kind of a mediocre, lukewarm, half-hearted Catholic. And her whole family was kind of lukewarm, mediocre, half-hearted Catholics. Until her mother was in a garden club. And after about 4 or 5 years in the garden club, was a woman who was a fervent, passionate, devoted, well-informed Catholic. And after about 4 or 5 years in the garden club, her mom became also an on-fire-for-the-faith Catholic because of her friend. And now my friend is no longer a lukewarm Catholic. She's a passionate, on-fire, involved Catholic who actually defended this Christian baker in Colorado. Okay? So you don't know. Yes, let's hear it. You don't know what your friendship will do. You must never doubt that if you have a healing, Christ-like friendship with someone, that will provide fruit. It's your job to do the work, and God will make the fruit flower. Okay? So with this person in mind, you've got this one person in mind, I want you to think about them in relation to the survivor chart. Okay? And we want to think, where is this person on the survivor chart? So I'm going to imagine a person, just a hypothetical person, say she's a survivor, her parents were divorced, and she also was involved in early sexual activity. Let's pretend this is a young friend that I have, okay? And so she's a refugee from the hookup culture and she's a child of divorce. So we think about who she is. Now let's ask ourselves, what was she told and what were her parents told? And why do we want to do this? We want to think about what were they thinking when they did all this. Well, if she's a child of divorce, her parents undoubtedly thought the kids were resilient and it would all be fine. If she is a refugee from the hookup culture, she undoubtedly thought that anything other than getting pregnant it is not a problem. You don't have to worry about it. There are no side effects of having casual sex. Nobody ever gets a broken heart over casual sex. All of those kinds of things that we have listed over there. All right? So now, with your person that you've thought of, maybe there are other things for them, okay? But we want to start with this so that we have in our mind and heart what's their mindset. What were they thinking? What were they feeling? All right? Now, is there anybody here from Fresno or the Central Valley? I met a couple people from the Central Valley on the elevator, so I know there are a few of you. Okay, the reason I'm bringing up Fresno and the Central Valley is because you all have out there, and you're going to testify to this, if this is true, you have something called the tool fog. Okay, Dr. Morse, why are you putting this blank thing on the screen here? I put this blank thing on the screen here because this is the tool fog. About 10 years ago, I was driving from San Diego here up to Fresno for an Irish dance competition with my 12-year-old daughter. And in the car, I also have my 15-year-old son and two foster children. Okay, and it gets dark, and we're off the freeway almost to our destination, and the fog comes in. And the tool fog comes in, and it is so thick you can't see to the end of your headlights. Now, you wonder, what is this a picture of? Let me show you. You see that arrow? Look there. That's the center line. That's the center line of the freeway. That's the shoulder. Yeah, that's the road for the shoulder. Okay, so here I am, off the freeway, driving as slow as I can, and my son says, "Mom, you're on the wrong side of the road," because he saw headlights coming right at us. So I zip off, you know, and I get myself into place and everything. That's the tool fog. Now, this is the cultural equivalent of the tool fog. We've got 12 survivors of the sexual revolution. 3 or 4 lies each have been told, retold, broadcast. Our legal institutions are built on these lies. I want you to understand that there are a lot of people driving down the wrong side of the road in a fog. That's just a fact. And when you've got a million people driving down the wrong side of the road in a fog, somebody is going to crash and burn. Okay, and that's an actual photo of a wreck that took place in 2001 up on Highway 99 near Fresno. Okay, so it's a big deal. So we have to have in our minds some compassion and gentleness with the people that we're dealing with. Even if it's your own kid, maybe especially if it's your own kid and you're furious with them because they left the faith and they did this and they did that and so on and so forth. By the way, you might not be able to save your own kid. I know a lot of you have that concern. But you might save somebody else's kid because they'll listen to somebody besides you, won't they? Right? A lot of times we're the last ones they'll listen to. All right, so now that you've got this person in your heart and you figured out where they're situated here, now's the time to inform yourself. Now's the time to go into the left brain mode or whatever it is with the facts and figures and all that stuff that y'all love. Now, I mean, I love it. I don't know about you guys. I'm crazy about this stuff. Anyway, now's the time to get some data. Okay? Think about, okay, if this is what they thought, if this is their situation, if they're a child of divorce, these are some of the things that they're dealing with, okay? That it's typical for a child of divorce to have persistent feelings of loneliness. That's not uncommon at all. It's typical for them to engage in early sexual activity. That's not uncommon at all. And why are you doing this? Because we're preparing ourselves to have this encounter. We have not yet said a single word to them, okay? But we're praying and meditating over this person. We're loving that person before we ever open our mouths. We're getting ourselves ready. So to review, we've picked that one person. We've prayed and meditated. We figure out where are they on the survivor chart. Then we've asked, what were they told? What were they thinking? And then we've informed ourselves so that we know that what they're going through is perhaps pretty typical and not unique to them. So we're ready for that part of the conversation. Now, we're ready to talk. And I do not suggest that you pick up the phone and say, "Hi, I want to talk to you. I need 45 minutes of your time. I got a presentation." No, you all have better sense than that. You're not going to do that. But as the occasion arises, as it might if you were in a garden club or something like that, or if you're fishing or going to a Padres game, God help us all. whatever it is, as it comes up naturally, you're going to have the opportunity to really engage with this person. And I don't want you to talk to them. I want you to listen to them. Listen, listen, listen. Elicit information from them, give them the chance to talk, give them the freedom to talk, okay? And there are three things only that I want you to be sure that you say to them, okay? The first thing, somewhere in your encounters with them, and you say this as many times as you think you need to, I'm sorry this happened to you. I'm so sorry this happened to you. And that can take a lot of different forms, but you're showing them compassion by saying that, because I think you can, in good conscience, say that you're sorry. You didn't want this to happen to them, right? Even if you're mad at them, even if they did something to you, you know, you still can feel, I'm sorry that this happened to you. Second, you can tell them you're not alone. You're not the only person who's had these feelings. You're not the only person who has done these things, who's responded to in this way. That's a time when you might actually pull out a pamphlet and share it with them, right? Look here, Dr. Morse found all this stuff about kids in your situation, and you know, you're not the only person who's gone through this, and I want you to know that. I don't want you to feel so alone. And then finally, it was not all your fault. Now, I want you to emphasize every word, because some of it might have been their fault, right, depending on the situation. But it certainly wasn't all their fault. And the reason you're saying that to them is to open the door to forgiveness for the part which was not their fault, so that they can move forward and deal with the part that was their fault, if indeed that's the situation. Children of divorce, children of same-sex parents, children of single parents, those types of situations that are irregular from the very beginning, they really are victims. But a lot of the other categories on here that are adult things, you know, we're participants, right? We share some responsibility for it. So we have to deal with that, okay? And the thing that I want to leave you with is that some of you are, in fact, going to be very good at this. And this is a lasting and Christ-like solution, because it's based on truth, it's based on love, it's based on the personal encounter. And when you're having this type of personal encounter, when you really convince somebody, or when you help somebody connect the dots between the ideology of the sexual revolution and the pain they're experiencing, once they make that connection, they're not going to be talked out of it by somebody's slick ad campaign. You know, that's going to be real. That's going to be lasting. Now, I have to close by telling you something rather serious in nature, okay? Which is that we have a long slog and a bitter fight ahead of us. This is very deep what we're dealing with. And the truth of the matter is that the alpha males of our society just love the sexual revolution. I mean, that's just a fact. This is beyond political parties, people. And if you're counting on the Republican Party to help you out, you have probably figured out that this is that it's a problem. All right, there are good people within the Republican Party, but the money bags people tend to dominate the conversation. And there aren't people on our side of the social issues who have anything like the amount of money that these other guys can bring to the table. Right? We're dealing with Bill Gates. We're dealing with George Soros, Warren Buffett, Paul Singer. I don't know if you've heard his name. Paul Singer is a big billionaire, a Republican billionaire who has been bankrolling gay marriage initiatives, and who's just done a lot of damage in that respect. And they're trying to take the social issues out of the political process because they like it the way it is. They like it, okay? And that's what we have to face up to. But here's the thing. If we all tell the truth about what happened to us, if we all reach out in solidarity and love with the people around us, they don't have enough money to shut us all up. They don't have enough money to talk us all out of it. And that is why this is a lasting and a Christ-like type of solution. We have our Lord's promise that the church will last until the end of time. I don't know if you've ever seen this meme on Facebook. Read it, guys. Usually people laugh at that when they see that. Have I freaked you all out already? What's going on here? Yeah, outlasting oppressive governments since 33 AD. Let me read it to you in case you can't read the print there. Okay, guys, let me remind you, you already know this, but the Catholic Church existed in catacombs for longer than the United States has had a constitution. Okay, I mean, just think about that. The Catholic Church was in catacombs for over 300 years, right? And so The Catholic Church is going to outlast the current crisis. We don't know how. We don't know where. We don't know how this is all going to do. How it's all going to go. But we do know that the Church will last, justice will last, and friendship and love will last. And that is why I am proud to stand with all of you as you reach out in justice and love to your friends and families who have been harmed by family breakdown. Thank you very much.
You've just been listening to Dr. J's talk, Keeping the Family Together, Public Policies and Personal Strategies, as part of the 3rd Annual Catholic Answers Conference, Restoring Marriage Today. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Moore's pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.